I'm ready.
Hey, good morning.
Hey, good morning, White for Wesleyan Church. Welcome to service this morning. So good to see you here. It's been a good week. And throughout the week, I've been kind of reading through some of the Psalms, and this Psalm just really stuck to me. And I thought we'd begin by reading it. It's Psalm 138. And it just says, I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. Is that what we're going to do this morning? Oh, five of you. That's not good. Let's try that again. Is that what we're here to do this morning? That's much better. I'll praise you with all my heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down toward your holy temple. I will praise your name for your love and your faithfulness, for you have exalted above all things your name and your word. And when I called, you answered me. You made me bold and stout-hearted. We're going to talk about that boldness that God calls us to have this morning. But God is great, is he not? Well, let's stand and sing this little chorus. Great is the Lord, he is holy and just. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice. Great is the Lord. Let's do it again this time. Sing, great are you, Lord, when we get there. Great is the Lord, he is holy and just. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great are you, Lord, now lift up your voice. I lift up my voice. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord? Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord, and worthy of glory. Great are you, Lord, and worthy of praise. Great are you, Lord. I lift up my voice. I lift up my voice. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness unto me. Who's thankful for the Lord's faithfulness this morning? I love this verse. Pardon for sin. Isn't that what it's all about? He's grateful. Make this your testimony. Pardon for sin and the peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Sing the chorus again. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faith. Sing that again. Great is thy faith. One more time. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Who's glad for his faithfulness this morning? Amen. Father, we're so glad as we come into your presence today to realize that that you are so faithful, you're so good to us, your mercy endures forever. We're so grateful that you saw us even in our sinful, you saw us there and you redeemed us, you pardoned us. And we're so grateful for that this morning. Just now, guide our thoughts, guide these moments together. May your presence just fill this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before you're seated, find five or six people and welcome them to the service this morning.
Good morning, church family. I hate to break up a good party, but if you could find your seats. Well, it's good to see Cameron back. Make sure you welcome him. And if you see Ron and Leslie smiling from ear to ear, that's because Duncan and family and grandson are here. So good to have you back, Duncan. And in the back, Daniel and Megan Kane are here. And you'll notice they're wearing masks. They came to our house for the 4th of July and didn't feel so well, so they tested and have COVID. So the quarantine period is over. They had very minor symptoms. Quarantine period is over, but they're wearing masks anyway and social distancing. So it's up to you how close you want to get to them. So welcome to the service. All right, some announcements this morning. Pastorick has a list of announcements. Got to make sure I cover them right. First of all, no youth tonight. However, on Wednesday, everything is back on. We're off for the VBS and other things, but everything is back on this Wednesday. And very importantly, kids, it's wet night. I know you all love to come to that and throw things at Pastor Rick. So make sure you come. There'll be a lot of water balloons and things that you can soak in. But make sure you bring clothes that can get wet. And out at the Welcome Center are these brochures, so you can give them to your friends, your neighbors, or whoever. It is a fun night. It is second most fun to the Color Run. So Color Run is a little more fun because that sticks with them longer. So make sure you get this brochure. We also have Bible studies, the ladies' Bible study on Thursday night. That is on, and men's breakfast prayer time on Saturday morning. So look in your bulletins for times on those. I think I covered the main announcements we have there. Now, if you guys have gone and looked at the Welcome Center, not only do you see this back there, but we have a lot of other things. We have The Light from the Word. This is the daily devotional book that's back there. I do this online, but there is an actual book back there. So take a look. You can pick that up. We also have Michigan Right to Life. Newspaper is back there on a regular basis. And this one I really like. Did you know the Wesleyan Church has its own newspaper or own magazine? So this is back there on the Welcome Center. It gives lots of information about the denomination, what's happening overseas. So this is our way, the church's way of communicating what's going on. So make sure you look that up as well when you're out there. And take them. They're out there for you to take. If we run out next month, we'll order more. So make sure that you get those things and look at them and stay connected with the church. All right. Amy's not here today, so that's good. Because the funeral for Russ memorial service is coming up, and we often provide food for the family and carry in meals, but this time we want to do things a little differently. Instead of bringing food to them, get gift cards to them from whatever restaurant you think they would like, or just a general cash gift card. Showing love to the family. This was a shock to all of us, but you can imagine what impact it's had on Amy and the family. So this will be us to her. That's why I said I'm glad she's not here to hear what we're planning to do. So you can either write a card, mail it to them, or give it to Pastor Rick, and Pastor Rick will make sure that she gets those cards. Just an expression of our love for the family, for them to know that we are really thinking about them. We miss seeing him in that pew. But this is our way of just a physical manifestation of love. Isn't that a great idea? So let's do it. Let's just overwhelm them with our love on that. Now stand with me if you would. I thought the announcement about Russ and the sadness we have of that is a good way to start and to lead into our verse for life today, because it says, don't be surprised when fiery trials come. He says they are going to come. They are going to happen. So the issue is, what do we do when those things happen? So let's read the verse together. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trials when they come upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. Amen. There's a little suffering now, but eternity we will join with him in the glory. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Now, you like to hear stories. Are you ready for a story for the hymn? Are you ready? You're not going to get one. There's a nice story for this, but there's an even more powerful story for our closing hymn. So we're going to hold it till the closing so you remember it immediately afterwards. But our hymn this morning is very powerful. Stand up for Jesus. That is what we need to do in the midst of trials, is to stand up. We know it's going to happen. He promised us it's going to happen. We just need to stand up for Jesus. So sing it out this morning, page 477, if you want the hymnal and music.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey. Forth to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Ye that are men now, serve him against unnumbered foes. Let courage rise with danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand up. Stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you. Ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, never wanting there.
I love this part. It tells us this isn't going to last for long. The battle will soon be over, and we will join him. Amen? I love this. Tune to the song. It is a triumphant song, isn't it? It's not a sadness that we face this battle. It's with joy and glee because we know who wins. Amen? Amen. It's much better to go into battle knowing we're going to win, and we're going to win. So let's sing this last verse. It won't last long.
Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Remain standing.
A while back, we taught you a chorus. Little prayer chorus this morning. It's called There's Nothing As Precious As You. Well, I'll sing it through once. Think you'll learn it quickly, and then we'll sing it through a couple times. It goes like this. There's nothing as precious as you, Lord. Nothing as precious as you. No one else is as dear to my heart. Nothing as precious as you. Nothing as precious as you. Let's try it together. There's nothing as precious as you, Lord. Nothing as precious as you. No one else is as dear to my heart. Nothing as precious as you. Nothing as precious as you. Well, you practiced it. Now let's sing it. Let's sing it like we mean it. There's nothing as precious as you, Lord. Nothing as precious as you. No one else is as dear to my heart. Nothing as precious as you. Nothing as precious as you. Let's just stand in silence. Let's pray before the Lord right now.
Father, we come before you with open hearts this morning, open hands to receive. We thank you for all that you do for us, your goodness, your greatness, your blessing. We know we live in an evil world and we need your power. We need your presence. We just pray that you'll open our eyes to the understanding of your word this morning. Help us to truly be the soldier that you want us to be able to stand up in the midst of all that's going on around us. Give us courage. Bless this moment now, I pray, as we look to your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Junior church this morning is with Benita, and let her get back there. And kids, you can go to be with her. I want to go back. Carol, can we go back to the verse for life? Because Mark left off a very important... Shame on Mark. But no, we love Mark. We got to read this part because it really kind of sets the tone for what we're talking about this morning. And I just want to, let's read it together, okay? So here we go. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. And that's 1 Peter 4, 12 through 14. In your Bibles, if you would, turn to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5. This week, we celebrated America's birthday. And we did so with barbecues and fireworks and time with family. And July 4th is hopefully a reminder of the incredible price that brave men gave to fight the tyranny of England, who ruled us at the time. And on the night that they signed the Declaration of Independence, 56 men who signed that knew that by doing that, they had signed their death sentence. Their signing was an act of treason, and treason was punishable by death. Now, these men were from all places in society. Many were lawyers, some were merchants, some were farmers, a plantation owner. There was a teacher, a musician, and one printer. These were men of means and education, yet they knew that by signing this document, that England would come looking for them. It was Benjamin Franklin who, after signing it, put the quill down and said the following: "We must indeed all hang together, or more assuredly, we will all hang separately." What would cause 56 men to risk it all, to put their families in harm's way, to lay their life on the line? They valued freedom and the promise it would bring to all of us. But signing it was costly. Five of the signers were captured by the British and tortured as traitors. Nine fought in the Revolutionary War and died from wounds or hardship. Two of the men lost their sons in the war, and two others had sons captured. At least a dozen of the 56 men had their homes pillaged and burned. All of them were willing to make the greatest of sacrifices that we might today have the freedom we enjoy, like worshiping together on this beautiful Sunday morning. Freedom is a great cause, but it's not the greatest. It's great. The greatest cause is to know the truth. Jesus said, "You will know the truth, and the truth will do what? Set you free." There's a greater freedom than just the freedom from a governmental entity. And that's the message that Jesus came preaching. He came proclaiming the words of the prophet Isaiah. The captives would be released and the prisoners set free. But what freedom? Freedom from what? Because Rome ruled at that time, the people believed that the Messiah would be a political savior to set them free from the Romans. But Jesus came expressing a different freedom, a freedom from a tyrant that's in our lives, not from Rome, but from sin. He offered a whole new way of life, freedom to enjoy fellowship with God. He came that we might experience and realize the abundant life, like John 10:10 says. And in spite of what's going on around us, and in spite of who's in charge, and in spite of who rules, we can be free. And that's kind of what he lays out here in this Sermon on the Mount that we've been studying. This incredible teaching, teachings that the people had not heard before. They had their rabbis and teachers, but listen to what the Bible says, that after Jesus was all done preaching, Matthew 7:28, when he had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as teachers of the law. He taught from a place that was expressing truth. And of all places to begin, Jesus starts out this message with 8 Beatitudes, all beginning with the word blessed and all concerning the shaping of our character. And we've looked at these in depth, and let me tell you, they're very convicting if we look at them really seriously. Verse 3, have we realized that we are spiritually bankrupt before the Lord? Verse 4, do we mourn over our sins and the sins of the world? Verse 5, are we gentle and meek and humble before God and others? Verse 6, is the things of the Lord our highest priority? Verse 7, do we show the same kind of mercy that we have received? Verse 8, is our heart truly pure? Verse 9, do we live out the gospel of peace with the people around us? The depth of each of these makes us stop and take inventory of our lives. It's a reminder that God's standard for our life has not been lowered. If anything, it raises it up. Because one of the key verses in all the sermons happens at the end of chapter 5, where Christ calls us to be perfect. And you say, wow, Pastor Rick, that's a tall order. How can I ever reach that level? And it's such a different message than the world gives. J.B. Phillips, he's a translator, and he cleverly paraphrased the Beatitudes like the non-Christian world would prefer them. Isn't this what we see today? These are the Beatitudes according to the world. Happy are the pushers, for they get out in the world. Happy are the hard-boiled, for they never let life hurt them. Happy are they who complain, for they get their own way in the end. Happy are the blasé, for they never worry over their sins. Happy are the slave drivers, for they get results. Happy are the knowledgeable men of the world, for they know their way around. And this one is so true. Happy are the troublemakers, for they make people take notice of them. You see, we live in two different irreconcilable value systems in our world. Just two. It is either God's way or man's way. There's no middle ground. Jesus said at the end of this great sermon, chapter 7, he said, you're either building your life on the rock, which is sure, or you're building your life on the shifting, sinking sands of man. And this is what happens when we truly begin to live out the Beatitudes, when we truly put them into practice in our life, when we begin to live the way God wants us to live, and we're living that life of holiness before God, all of a sudden there becomes a collision between those two value systems. Jesus wraps up this part of the message in verse 10 where he says, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That's not kind of a blessing that we want, is it? I mean, a show of hands, how many truly want to be persecuted? This verse doesn't imply that every single one of us will know constant persecution if we live out these Beatitudes. Nor does it bemoan persecution that comes upon us because of poor choices. It says here, when we are persecuted because of righteousness, it does mean that the world will come after those whose value system is different than theirs. John MacArthur writes, those who live righteously in the world at some time or another are going to know the rebuke of the cross. I was talking with somebody one time and they made the comment, well, I just want to be like Jesus. And I said, you know what that means? You want to be like Jesus. Do you know what that means? Isaiah 53. He was a lamb that was led to the slaughter. He was despised and rejected. He was spit upon. He was crucified. And according to the gospel writers, his own family didn't believe him. One of my favorite verses in all of the Bible is Philippians. I want you to turn there real quick. You got your Bibles? Turn to Philippians 3:10. because it makes such an incredible point. And I love what Paul says. It's like an exclamation. He's starting this by saying, "Oh, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection." Isn't that good? Would you like to be there? "Oh, that I would know him and the power of his resurrection." You want to know the power of his resurrection this morning? I'd like to have that. I want that more than anything else. The power to overcome, the power to experience an incredible life, the power, the confidence and courage, the power over all my fears. Who wants that this morning? Five of you? Come on. Who wants that this morning? Okay, good. But wait, there's another part of the verse that you might not like to read. We all want that. We want the power of his resurrection, absolutely. But there's a second part of the verse. And how can the second part of the verse be just as important as the power of his resurrection in our lives? Notice what it says. Not only do we want to know the power of his resurrection, but Paul says, and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. I say, whoa, wait a minute. hold the phone there. You see, Paul recognized and experienced that by living the kind of life Jesus preached in the Beatitudes would bring about suffering from others. The message of the cross and the message of Christ is simply this: to live in my kingdom isn't about fame or glory or prestige or acceptance and everybody loving you. It's totally different. You're going to live contrary to the world. My kingdom will bring you freedom, but it will also bring you trouble. You say, why? Let me give you a couple of examples from the Beatitudes. The world cannot tolerate someone who mourns over sinfulness because the world wants to bypass sin altogether and continue to convince itself that it's right and we're wrong. The world knows nothing about purity, little about mercy, and has never learned how to live in peace. And here's the truth that we find in verses 3 through 9. The more we live out these character traits in the world, the more likely there's going to be a reaction. Listen to what Paul said to a young pastor in 2 Timothy chapter 3. He says, "Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted." You say, well, Pastor Rick, that was then when being a Christian meant there was a price to be paid. That was then when there was a time when believers were hunted down, thrown into the arena with the lions, burned alive. We don't have that here. We're tolerant people. But friends, listen to me. This is happening all over the world. Some nations have made laws outlawing Christianity. Some religions allow for murder a person who converts to Christianity. To be a Christian in some places means that you will give up your family, you'll give up your livelihood, you give up your country. And according to one statistic I read this week, 833 believers around the world lose their life every day because they've stood up for Christ. 833 a day. I'll show you a picture. When I was in Liberia several years ago, I made a friend. His name's Choma. Choma was a pastor of a Wesleyan church in one of the bigger cities in Liberia. Rebels began a war in Liberia, and they almost succeeded in winning. They were able to take control over several of the bigger cities, including the city where Choma was preaching. And one night he was out. He didn't mean to be out, but he had to go get something, and he was accosted by several rebels who knew that Choma was a preacher. They surrounded him and threatened Choma with his life if he kept on preaching, and they hacked off his arm with a machete as a warning. And Choma was able to get back to his family and recover and continue to preach the gospel. Ladies and gentlemen, we're blessed, aren't we, to live in a country where we still have the freedom to believe in Jesus and speak about Jesus. And that all is protected, but the question is, for how long? It's coming under attack. Do you realize this? It's coming under attack. A business in Colorado has now been sued twice, once taking the case all the way to the Supreme Court over their refusal to make a cake for a same-sex couple. A coach in the state of Washington lost his job because he knelt and he prayed after a team's game. The Christian charity, the nuns, the Little Sisters of the Poor, was sued by the department, our own people were sued by the Department of Health and Human Services over the refusal to pay for contraceptive services for their employees. Churches were forced to shut down during the pandemic, but liquor stores and casinos and strip clubs were allowed to stay open. Our friends to the north just passed a law that says you must address people by their preferred pronouns or you will face jail time. Persecution is coming if it's not already here. And Jesus said the following. This is what you're going to face. Notice verse 11, chapter 5, verse 11. He gives us three kinds of persecution. In fact, the first thing he says is you'll be persecuted. The word persecution there means harassed. It'll mean chased away. I want you to think about this. Anytime you make a statement of truth from God's word, there will be a reaction. Think about it. You take a stand for life, you'll get challenged. You challenge somebody's worldview or their sinfulness, you'll get harassed. You tell someone about their eternal soul and their destiny without Christ, you'll get laughed at. Boldness in our society today will bring trouble. It's nothing new. Just ask John the Baptist. It's an incredible, crazy story. John the Baptist, Mark chapter 6. The king at that time, his name was Herod, and Herod decided that his brother's wife, that he wanted his brother's wife, so he just went and got her. Made his brother divorce her, took him as his own bride, and John the Baptist went to the king and said, "What you're doing is wrong. You can't do that." And because of that, Herod's new wife, her name was Herodias, she was upset. Listen to what the Bible says. This is chapter 6, verse 19. When Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him, but she was not able to. You got to read the story. Go back. It is an incredible story. Because later on, she gets her wish. Now, I'm not saying this morning that we're going to lose our heads. But when we are willing to confront the world, people will lose theirs. They'll go crazy. They'll harass. But remember, we have the truth. Jesus said, we'll be reviled. The word there means mocked. The literal translation means to cast in one's teeth. It means to growl, to scorn, to use vile, vicious words. Be ready for character assassination. It happened to Jesus. What was he criticized about? Look at this man. He eats with prostitutes and sinners and tax collectors. Several years ago, Reggie White, who was an ordained minister, a linebacker for the Green Bay Packers, after his retirement, spoke passionately in front of the Wisconsin lawmakers and condemned a law that they were passing about an immoral lifestyle of many. And as a result, he was publicly rebuked by the Wisconsin legislature. He was called vicious, ignorant, and crazy. An offer that CBS had given to him to be a commentator for football games was withdrawn. He paid a high penalty for sharing the truth. And you probably heard some of the names that are thrown against us these days. We're haters. We're bigots. We have phobias. We're zealots. We're intolerant. I hear those words and I say, that's not fair. That's not right. I'm not any of those things. I'm not that way at all. But it shouldn't surprise us. It shouldn't surprise us at all, because when we live out the truth, it goes against a culture that does not believe the truth. And Jesus said, men will not like you. They'll revile you. They'll hate you. They'll sow all manner of evil against you. And that's the last thing he says. We'll have false things said about us. Jesus said all manner of false things. Did you realize that the early church went through, it's hard to believe this, But the early church, the Romans actually accused the early church of cannibalism because they used the words of Jesus in their communion to eat his flesh and drink his blood. And the Romans actually said, yeah, they're eating each other. And then they accused the early church of these big gatherings of lust because the early church called them love feasts. And when they kissed each other, there was a kiss of affection, of friendship. The Romans said, yeah, that kiss of peace was an illicit part of that gathering. And the Christians were blamed for the burning of Rome. They were accused of being political rebels. Let me give you an example of that time. Rome declared that the emperor should be worshipped. And so you had to go one time a year, you had to go to the temple and burn a pinch of incense to Caesar and say, Caesar is Lord. And when a person did that, they were given a certificate called a labellus. And a labellus then allowed a person to go and worship them for the rest of the year in whatever way they wanted. However, the Christians refused to compromise. Their loyalty was Christ above everything else. And as a result, they became rebels, and many of them lost their lives. I like what one writer expressed, that the persecutors, they really don't hate you. They hate Christ. Why? Because the truth exposes the darkness, and the darkness revolts against it. Jesus said, if the world hates you, know this, it hated me first. You say, well, Pastor Rick, I don't want any persecution in my life. Who does? I'm not out there trying to make it happen. And one surefire way not to have any persecution in your life is to be silent. To be a silent Christian. Just go along with the world. Approve of what the world is doing. Never stand up for Jesus. Never mean what we sang just a little bit ago. John records these words of Jesus. If you belong to the world will love you as its own. You won't have any problem then. But Jesus said, whoever's ashamed of me, of him, I will be what? Ashamed. And no matter what we give up here, verse 12 reminds us, we'll gain there. Whatever we have to go through here, it's so small. It's so minuscule to what the Lord has prepared. He says, great is your reward in heaven. If you don't remember when we started this study, we talked about these eight verses, these first eight verses as attitudes. Not the external show of our religiosity, not how we're going to be perceived, not how well we can pray and all that, but the inner qualities that make for a perfect person. This beatitude that we studied this morning is like the other seven. It is an attitude of willingness to allow persecution to happen, to face it, not to fear it, a willingness to accept the result of living the beatitude kind of life. And I guess this morning, if we're honest, this is where we all struggle. We do. Well, the question I ask, am I at a place where I can truly sing about the cross, its shame and reproach gladly bear? Am I willing to stand up for Jesus, to stand up for truth, knowing that it might take away some of the freedoms I have, that it might bring harassment and scorn upon my life? Am I willing to do that for a freedom that will last for eternity? What was it that each of the disciples were willing to lay their life down for? Each one of them, other than John, faced a martyr's death. What was it that the early church historians and the early church translators and missionaries around the world are willing to lay their life down for? It's the gospel, the truth, and the world desperately needs to see the truth.
Are we willing? The signers of the great Declaration of Independence put their name on the dotted line that we might have freedom. But I'm asking us to put our name on the dotted line of the kingdom. The people who see the truth in us might come to freedom, might know freedom, might be able to live in freedom. But it's an attitude of willingness to say, whatever comes, Lord, whatever comes, I'm willing to pay the price. I'm willing to go all the way with you. I'm not going to turn my back on you. I'm going to stand up for Jesus, no matter what.
Stand, if you would. The story, you don't know when it occurred, who the family was, but it's been reported by
many different people, and it's in many hymnals in India, but in the north of India, about 150 years ago, missionaries went and taught, and this man and his wife and two sons came to know the Lord, and they were dedicated. And other people in the village began to turn to Christ as well. And the leader of the community didn't like what was going on. So he found out who started this movement. And he brought the family in front of him and all the people there and charged him and said, turn your back, deny Christ, or I will kill you. And the man said, I have decided to follow Jesus. There is no turning back. The chief then ordered his two sons to be executed, and they were killed. And then the priest turned to the man again and said, I'll give you another chance. You and your wife will live if you deny Christ. And he said, the world's behind me. The cross is before me. There is no turning back. And so his wife was killed. And the chief said, this is your final chance. Deny Christ, and I will let you live. And he said, though no one will join me, still I will follow. I am not turning back. And he was executed. The community was shocked at the dedication of this family. And the chief was shocked, and he began to look into it. And before long, he realized that this is the true way. And he and his family and nearly the whole village came to know Christ. And word spread around about this story, and there was a revival in the area. And that's why it is included in so many of the hymnals. And then it was translated into English for us today, so we can hear his testimony, the testimony of this family facing death. And we think of a sadness, but they got their reward. They did not turn back. And they are now with their Savior. So as you sing this today, it meant a lot to them that said it. Does it mean the same to you? No matter what, I am not turning back. Let's sing it together, okay?
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back.
Now here is our challenge. Will you decide to follow Jesus? That's the question today. Let's sing it.
Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? No turning back, no turning back.
Amen.
Is that an amen moment? Though none go with me, it's going to be a lonely, dark road in the years to come. Evil's going to continue to abound because we know that. Scripture tells us that until the Lord returns, there will be persecution. There will. It's coming if it's not already here. Men will revile you. They'll say all manner of evil against you. Why? That last verse says we have the cross before us, the world behind us. That's the two world systems. Live for the cross. There will be these things that Jesus said. But don't turn back, whatever you do. The reward is so much greater than any kind of persecution, any kind of thing that we might go through here. Remember what Jesus says. Your reward is great. Your reward is great. No turning back. No turning back. Let's say that with me. No turning back. One more time. No turning back. Are you there with me?
Amen.
Okay. Before we go, Denny, can you give us an update on your brother? Denny's brother had open heart surgery yesterday and wasn't doing too good. Is there an update you can give us?
Heart attack last night. Well, I had quadruple bypass, and he had his valve replaced, and had new platelets. And last night we were up there, and they had to take him back in, and he had a heart attack. They put two more stents in, and I just got an update that I'm going to have to take him back in because the heart's not working properly.
His name is Mark. Let's pray for Mark as we close this morning. Father, our prayer this morning in the midst of an evil world, that you'll help us to shine forth, not be ashamed of our light, and never to be ashamed of the truth, no matter what we may come against us. Evil cannot prevail. It will not. We have the truth, and the truth has set us free. And no matter what tyranny of the society we will face, we can be free in our souls because of what you have done for us on Calvary. And may we go forth with that confidence today, assurance that we stand on the side that's of victory. We stand on the side that will be forever, and not to ever be ashamed of that, no matter when. May this truly be that moment where we say, no turning back. I'm not giving in, not going back. I'm going to stand up and be counted for Christ no matter what. And Father, we pray for Mark today, Lord, as we hear this, what has happened in his life, and just pray that you will bring healing now to his body and his heart. We pray for the doctors as they perhaps have to go in and do surgery again, to help them to find out what's causing the problem. And we just pray for deliverance for this man. We pray for Amy. Lord, we pray for her wherever she is today. Would your Holy Spirit now bring comfort and peace upon her in these days? Just may she know that you are ever so near. You're always right there. That is your promise. You are Emmanuel, the one who is with us. May she experience that today. Now, Lord, we're going to go face the hostile world out there. We're going to go face a world that does not know you, whose value systems are so much different than ours. May we go with a smile on our face, with excitement in our hearts, joy in our minds, and the promise of God upon our lips. And wherever we go, may we be that salt and light that you've called us to be, no matter what, no turning back. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. That was a great story, wasn't it? Boy, you'll never forget that. God bless you as you go. Have a great day.